So the video I did a few videos back on creating an electric brake for the treadmill motor on my lathe has been very popular. I've gotten a lot of positive feedback, I've gotten a lot of comments, and I've actually gotten a lot of questions. And I'm hoping to address some of those questions and maybe, just maybe, find an option that is a little more economical to set up a braking resistor on a treadmill motor. Greetings, fellow DIYer, and welcome to my video. Before we get into this janky setup, I wanted to take the time to show you what you could not see in the last video. I recently did a video on chokes, and I set up a camera to film the back of the motor, showing the arcing that can happen inside the motor if you're not running a choke, or if the choke you're running is not as good. While I had the camera set up, I took the time to set up the braking switch that appeared in my first video and show you the flash that I mentioned to where you can see the difference between using a resistor and not using a resistor. There's no arcing, there's no flash when we use a resistor. There is a pretty good flash when we just directly short out the motor. And that right there, that flash, that arcing, it's hard on the inside of the motor, it's hard on the brushes, it's hard on the commuter, which is the copper piece inside the motor. And by running a resistor, we eliminate the flash. And so that's why the resistor is so important. Talking about a resistor brings me to this mess. So the number one question I got was, how did you figure out how big a resistor you needed? And the way I did it was I looked at the specs on the motor and it gave me volts and it gave me amps. And that's all it takes to get watts, amps times volts. So when functioning as a motor, this one in particular is 21 amps at 130 volts DC. Now, amps times volts equals watts. And that would mean that if this was working at 100% efficiency, this would be putting out somewhere in the neighborhood of 2,500 watts. Now, the good news is when this is functioning as a generator, it's not going to be at peak efficiency. So we're not going to have that high an amperage or that high a voltage. The other factor is the braking action is rapidly dissipating the speed on this, which means the voltage is going to drop very quickly. So I bought the original 1,000-watt resistor and put it through its paces, tried it, did lots of things with it, so that I could see if it was adequate, if it was enough, even though it was about half of what the calculation said I needed. And it worked great. I was very successful in the fact that this drops so quickly that we're not putting large wattage through that. But a lot of the comments I got were things like, the research I've done says you can use a 200 or a 300 watt resistor. And that got me thinking, is that a viable option? So I got to looking around. I went on Amazon and I found these resistors. Now, these are only 100 watts. And in theory, one of these is going to be insufficient. But here's what's cool about this project. When you wire resistors in parallel, you get to add the wattage. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That means this setup right here can handle 800 watts, pretty close to the 1,000-watt resistor that I originally ran on the original video. So today's experiment is going to find out what our bare minimum is. So I'm going to power the system on, I'm going to bring it up to full speed, and then I'm going to slam on the brakes. And once it comes to a stop, I'm going to use my multimeter to measure the resistance here to confirm that I haven't burned out any of these resistors. And then I'm going to disconnect one resistor so that it is 700 watts. And we're going to do the same experiment. And then 600 watts. And then 500 watts. And we're going to just keep coming down until one of these resistors fails. And at that point, we'll know what the bare minimum requirement is, and then we can add more from there to have something that's going to function well. The best part about using resistors like this is you can get a 4-pack of these for about 10 bucks. A link to these will be in the description below. So let's go ahead and give this a try and see how it goes. Half an ohm. That tells me all the resistors survived. So let's remove one and go again. Still at 0.6 ohms, so all of the resistors survived. I wish that I'd had a better way to connect these, but I didn't have a connection bus to be able to make this look all professional. So I just ended up having to make my own. Same reading. So that shows they all survived. You can see as the resistance going up, it is definitely taking a little longer for that to slow. Same reading. So our resistors survived. Let's remove another. Now these resistors are starting to get warm. I think I'm going to let them cool a little bit before we conduct the next round of this experiment. And those have definitely cooled off, so I'm going to pull another one. And that brings us down to 300 watts. Three resistors, 300 watts. See, that one took a lot longer. And these resistors are quite warm. Let's measure. All right, we are at 1.5, which is right where we should be for three resistors. So we are now down to two resistors. They're at 200 watts between the two of them. This is a great demonstration that as the number of resistors decrease, the amount of resistance increases. And that directly translates to a slower stopping speed, it taking a little bit longer for it to stop. And these resistors now are quite hot. I couldn't hold those if I wanted to. We're sitting at 2 ohms though. Both of them are still good. All right, we are cooled off enough for our final test. So I'm going to power it up, bring it up to speed, and see if we can burn out this resistor. That took by far the longest. Ooh, and that is really hot. But the question is it still good? The answer is yes, the resistor still is good. So what have we learned here? We've learned that this resistor is probably way more than what the average person is going to need for their setup. That is a 1,000-watt resistor. This is a 100-watt resistor. Oh man, that's hot. But what you also didn't get to see was that when I had all 8 resistors, 7 resistors, even down to 6, I was still getting a pretty good flash inside this motor. So you definitely want to have at least 1 ohm of resistance to balance between having the quickest stopping we possibly can and minimizing the arcing and potential damage to the motor. 1 resistor, super hot, not a good option. So if I were to install this as a braking resistor and then start, say, let's say I was threading, where I'm making a cut and then I have to stop, and then I'm making a cut and then I have to stop, heat is going to build up in this, and heat is the enemy of a resistor. The other issue with this is this has 4 ohms of resistance, and so it is taking the longest to stop the motor. I'm thinking 4 or 5 of these is probably the sweet spot. The more of these you have, the better it's going to dissipate heat. So by having more, they're all going to take the load of that heat, and that's going to help significantly. And again, 4 or 5 is probably sufficient. So this is a far more budget-friendly option than this big one that I got before. This big one is probably bulletproof. I never am probably going to run the risk of burning the big one out. But I think 4 of these or 5 of these should be a pretty good way to go. Keep in mind that this bench test is an extreme. How often are we going to be running the lathe or the mill or whatever we're powering with this treadmill motor at wide open? Most of the time, I mean, the reason we get a variable speed motor is so we can slow it down. So most of the time we're going to be running pretty slow, and way less wattage is going to be going into these resistors. I hope this information helps. I'm also going to give you a teaser of an upcoming video. I was making a post about this project back when I was using the big resistors on the Mill Lathe Combo Facebook page that I'm a part of. And one of the guys there said to me, he's like, I love this braking system, but I don't like the switch. I don't like that you have to manually hit a switch to have it brake. Isn't there some way we could make this automatic? And that got me thinking, that's a fantastic idea. That's more user-friendly on the lathe. If I cut the power, the brake engages. If I turn it from forward to neutral, the brake engages. If I turn it from reverse to neutral, the brake engages. Now that's a little easier said than done, because we're having to deal with 2 separate switches, the direction switch and the main power switch. But I was able to come up with a solution, and that will be an upcoming video. So make sure you subscribe and stay tuned, because we are going to put together an automatic brake, and we should have a pretty good setup.
If you like what you've seen, please click like. If you'd like to see more, please subscribe. Thanks for watching.